Good evening, everyone. Thank you for coming out on such a miserable Melbourne winter night. My name is William Mora. I'm sitting between Trevor Graham, who has directed Monsieur Mayonnaise, and my brother Philippe Mora, who narrates and stars in and tells a family story in Monsieur Mayonnaise. We're going to sort of chat about the film, so I'm assuming most of you here were at the screening last night. Otherwise, it mightn't make a lot of sense what I'm going to say. It was great to see the film last night on a large screen, and I'd only seen it previously on a laptop, and I think the response was fabulous. We managed to get our mother, Merka, there, who kind of giggled her way through it, said she spent last night dreaming about her father and baguettes and mayonnaise. And I'll tell you a little secret here, she thinks she makes better mayonnaise than my brother Philippe does. Trevor, I guess I probably should start this off. I know you've answered this question many times, but how did you first get involved with the Mora story and with Philippe, and how did you decide to take that further into a documentary film on our family history?
Well, I first knew about Philippe from Swastika and Brother, Can You Spare a Dime? Because I saw both those films in the early and mid-70s at this very festival. And both of those films have stayed with me since. And in my humble opinion, I think they're your best films. And that's not to say that I don't like your other films, but then as a documentarian...
How do you say fuck off?
Fair enough. As a documentarian...
Now you know I'm sitting in the middle. I might just lean forward.
Thank you. And stop interrupting. As a documentarian, of course, I'm going to say that. But then many years later, I was working at SBS as a commissioning editor, and Philippe and a Melbourne producer approached me to do a film which is a bit like Brother, Can You Spare a Dime, a film about the 60s, and using compilation footage to recreate the 60s in effect. And I was very keen on doing that at SBS, but for one reason or another, it didn't happen. So, you know, I just knew about Philippe's work as a filmmaker. I knew he was Merka and George's son, and you know, brother William and Tyriel. I knew all of that, but I didn't know that Philippe was also an artist and had been practicing as an artist going right back into essentially his childhood. So that I became aware of via Facebook. I would just sort of saw Philippe Mora's name pop up on Facebook one day, as you do, and pressed friend request, and bingo, not much later, I got a acceptance. And so I started to, you know, get all of Philippe's posts, and he does a wonderful array of posts on Facebook from, you know, family history, family photos, bits of family movie even, things that he's painted, his artworks going right back to the 60s. And of course, you know, film works as well, information about film works. So I just thought, this is really new, this is really interesting for me. And so one day I sent him a request saying, hey, I've made this film called May Commerce Not War. I'm a filmmaker. We kind of, you know, had a phone conversation when I was at SBS. And you interested in maybe working up a film idea together? And that's literally where it all started. It started on Facebook.
Thank you. Is that your version of the story?
No. that is my version. But the only missing thing is I really liked Trevor's film, Make Humus Not War. I just thought it was very, 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 very good film. And I think I said last night that I like the way that Trevor treats serious subjects with a very light touch, which really is a gift. It's very hard to do. And there's so many serious, tragic subjects around, which people, actually it's horrible to say, but so many boring films about serious subjects, they're almost unwatchable. And, I'm smiling because I just made a comedy called French Movie, and there's a film critic who says, we have a new genre in French cinema. In French, it is translated as unwatchable. But anyway, Trevor and I make watchable films. We make watchable films. We just got on. We got on. And actually, one critic today, there was a very good review of the film. Excuse me, I lost my voice somewhere over the Pacific. But the reviewer said that Trevor Graham found a soulmate to work with in the film, and I think we are soulmates. So it was a pleasure, really, the whole thing. And it was a real kick for me as a director to be directed. Directors take direction really well. I mean, it's great. You know, Trevor said, could you move to the right a little bit? Oh, yeah, no problem. Could you move to the left a bit more now? No problem. And I was very cooperative. And so it was a great collaboration, and Trevor was a bit tricky sometimes in not telling me what was going to happen, which I accepted. So he wouldn't tell me, you know, and some of these things were quite startling to me. You can see in the film, like he didn't tell me who Dr. Henri Perrons was. He said we're meeting this psychiatrist. I don't think he even said that. And he just wouldn't tell me, so that he captured them. That's why there's a lot of real moments.
It was actually a really difficult thing to do, because Philippe and I do engage and banter quite a lot about, you know, what we do and what we think, and particularly, I think we both share an interest and a passion for anything to do with the Führer and the Second World War and the 1930s. I mean, that's why I was interested in Brother, Can You Spare a Dime? I made a film, in fact, my first film that was shown at this festival in 1985 was a film called Red Matildas, which was about three Australian women who were communists in Melbourne and Australia during the 1930s. So, you know, there's sort of lots of similarities and crossovers in our interests. So we sometimes can't shut up when we're talking about, you know, certain things. So it was very difficult not to let him know these bits of crucial information, which were sort of helping to shape the story, like, you know, Henri Perrons, or I didn't tell you very much about Georges Loigner, the 105-year-old former resistant. I just told him, you're going to meet someone who knew Marcel Marceau, and that was it. He had no idea that he was the cousin of Marcel Marceau, that he was 105 years old. I just said, look, you're going to meet this old guy. That's it. And so it allowed for that kind of fresh spontaneity of response that you see in the film. I think when George says, I'm from Alsace and I'm 105 years old, you burst out clapping.
Yeah, that's right. Well, he said to me, one of the things he kept saying, he's 105, so I was listening to what he wanted to tell me, but he repeated a few times, he said, no one realizes how tough it was to fight the Germans. He said the Germans were really tough. I'm implying, of course, he was tougher because he's standing there. But he said they were really, really brutal. And he said, De Gaulle, he proudly said, De Gaulle gave me this Legion d'honneur. And I said, what was De Gaulle like? And he said, in English, hard-boiled.
It was an interesting, sorry to interrupt, but I am the moderator here.
Yeah,
it was interesting, the research you did on that front, Trevor, you really have to be highly commended. One of the documents that came out was George's employment contract with Ose. And under job description, it sort of had a colon, and then it just had clandestine activities. And then it had monthly salary, 2,500 French francs, or whatever it was. But the level of research that's gone into this film, Trevor, I know for our family, was a revelation. We had a sort of sketchy idea from what we've been able to glean from our parents and other friends from that time. But we, you uncovered for us, which on a personal level has been fabulous. We now really do know the complete story. So thank you for that.
Wouldn't you like to know more about those clandestine activities, though? Because I feel like we only scratched the surface and we don't really know the full...
No, we're only discovering about these clandestine activities in Melbourne now.
That's right.
we would, yeah, I mean, it's the stuff of novels.
He did tell us some things which we now know based on the fact that everything else is true. What he would say, now we know when it's all true, that some of the things he told us must be true, I'm assuming, but one of the big things was he was trying to kill a count who was a collaborator throughout the war. The resistance was trying to kill this count. And every time they tried to get him, he would not show up, he didn't cross the bridge, the party didn't happen, they could never get this guy. And he was throwing parties for Goering, and they really wanted to get him. And at the end of the war, de Gaulle threw a big party for all the resistance leaders. And my father was very high up, and he was at this party. He looked up and he sees the count coming in the doorway. And he just couldn't believe it. And the guy's and walking towards George. And he's really uncomfortable. And the count comes up to my dad and he says, "You did a fantastic job, George. I was the one giving you all the orders to kill me." And that's why they could never get him, because he would just, you know, he'd give the order to kill him and he just wouldn't show up. It wouldn't go quite, you know. But that's how complex the resistance was.
Well, that wasn't in the film.
There's lots of things that aren't
in the film.
In the sequel.
The musical that's coming.
Saucepan's sequel.
That was, for us, for Philippe and I, obviously it's a very personal thing, and Trevor can kind of have that one step back to deal with a subject that is very personal. I think you just touched on this morning, the observer as opposed to the participant in your interview with John Fain, talking about documentary filmmaking. And I think, Trevor, you've been able to kind of tell our story in a wonderful way. It is a heavy subject, but by having what we now know as your light touch, it's made it very bearable, and I think people really enjoy it, and I think the message that comes through is taken much more seriously when you can laugh at these obviously very, very serious
issues. I've spent a lot of time with blackfellas, with Aboriginal people making films, and they're first to laugh at their own tragedy, you know, what has befallen them, and make light of it and find a humorous way to deal with the heaviness of it all. And I said this last night, and it's a tagline that I like to use, and it's an old Jewish, I was digging around on the internet one day looking at sort of Jewish expressions, and one of them that came up was, "We laugh so we don't cry." And I just think that's a really fantastic line for dear. And you say it yourself about Philippe's work, that about his horror films, that sort of like, you know, you've got a touch of the comedic about you as a way of dealing with the horrors of the past.
Well, one of my best friends here is the comedian Ostentatious, who's Jewish, and he reminded me of a story I told him about Mel Brooks in Germany. Mel Brooks. It was on TV, and the interviewer said, "Why do you think it is that the Germans have no sense of humor?" And Mel Brooks said, "Well, didn't it occur to you that you killed all the funny people?" There's another story.
Well, the funny people went to Hollywood as well.
There's another story along those lines, which is I had the privilege, really, to have dinner with Walter Matthau and his wife, I'd say 10 years ago, something, 15 years ago, and the subject of the Holocaust came up. And Walter Matthau, maybe I told this story last night, I don't know, forgive me if I'm repeating it. But Walter Matthau said that he wanted to take his wife to Auschwitz. So they went to Auschwitz, and on the way there, he said they had the most horrendous fight they'd ever had in their whole marriage about something. It was just the worst fight. So when they got there, she said, "Walter, I can't do Auschwitz with you. I need to go on separate tours. It's a 3-hour tour." And he said, "Okay." And she said, "We'll meet afterwards, but I'm not doing this with you." And she walked off. 3 hours later, they made up again. And she said, "Walter, you really ruined Auschwitz for me." Well, we're laughing at that. It's fantastic. And when you imagine how serious it is. Now, I'm going to ask you a couple more questions, and then we might ask if there are any questions from the audience, I think. The process, you were saying, was about 3 years from beginning to research to the screening last night?
The Facebook contact happened in about February 2013. Philippe came to Melbourne and to Sydney in about, I think it was May that year. He was promoting his film German Sons, so we did a little bit of filming then, none of which, even though it was good material, none of which made it into the film.
All the good things have been cut out of the film.
Philippe is always saying to me, "Why did you cut that scene? Why did you cut that scene? They're good scenes." I said, "Yeah, they're great scenes."
It's a technique. Yeah, it's a special technique.
Anything that a good
Trevor notices, he cuts out. It's very effective.
So then we had a bit of a technical hitch financing a film that year. We didn't get any money. So I then decided to say to Philippe, look, originally we started off with a really big concept about Philippe making a graphic novel, a comic book, about the history of his family across the length and breadth of the 20th century. That's where this idea started. I pitched that to Screen Australia. It was a bit undercooked as an idea, and it didn't get anywhere. It just didn't get any support financially. So, but they said, "Look, keep on doing something. You know, try and develop the idea a bit more." And I went back to Philippe and said, "Look, why don't we concentrate on the Monsieur Mayonnaise story, because it's such a fantastic story. You know, and we just focus on what happened during the war and all the drama that you see in the film associated with that," because Philippe and I talked about it endlessly. And so I then re-pitched that to Screen Australia. I went over to Los Angeles with Jenny Meaney, my DOP, and the two of us shot for a week some material. We came back, we cut together a 15-minute trailer, we pitched that to Screen Australia and to MIFF, and they loved it. You know, that's how the project got up. And I also went to Amsterdam to the International Documentary Festival of Amsterdam, which is a big marketplace for pitching films, and that's where Arte, ZDF Arte, the French-German broadcaster, got involved. So it goes all the way back to 2013, but serious shooting started really in 2014. And the birth of the project from beginning to end is 3 years, which is nothing really in the scheme of things. It's quite short.
Do you think having Arte as a supporter will ensure that it has an international exposure as well as just something, an Australian exposure?
Well,
Arte is a very prestigious
organisation
in Europe.
It is. I've kind of reached a stage in my career where unless something's got some international potential, it doesn't really appeal to me. Like, I think this is a very Australian story. I think it's a very Melbourne story as well. But as you saw in the film, it's got international dimensions, and it's drawing in all the kind of interconnectedness of what happened during the war and post-war. And they're the sort of stories that appeal to me because by nature they're bigger in scope. And therefore they've got more potential to get out there as stories to an international audience. So to answer your question, it'll go to air across Germany, potentially with, 60 million people in Germany, and there's 50 million people in France. Now, public broadcasters in those countries, like public broadcasters here, have smaller percentage of audiences, a smaller demographics, but it's still millions of people that are going to see this film across those two countries.
Will it be the same version that was shown last night?
I'm afraid to tell you that you're going to be dubbed into German.
Are you cutting me out? Are you cutting me out of the film?
You're not being cut out of the film, but you are. You will have a German voice.
Trevor's now painting as well, by the way. Yeah.
The French are actually more sophisticated. They're subtitling, thank God. But the films will be exactly the same. The versions will be exactly the same, apart from the subtitling and the dubbing.
One last question, perhaps, before we throw it open. I've had a lot of SMS and texts from people today saying, when are they going to be able to see it theatrically in Melbourne?
Okay, there will be a theatrical release. It'll be sometime in October. I can't confirm the dates yet because I don't actually know them, but there'll be event styles, like 2 days in Melbourne, Sydney, Canberra, Brisbane and Perth. And there'll be a season potentially at the Classic in Austenwick and also at the Lido in Hawthorne and maybe at the Nova. I'm probably giving all this information out and I shouldn't be, but yes, there will be opportunities.
Philippe, thanks, Trevor. Philippe, a lot of people have said to me, God, your brother is just a natural actor. Have you ever thought maybe you should be on the other side of the camera? I mean, not on the director's side, but on the acting side?
Well, I've been doing it a bit. I have been doing a bit, yeah. But it's all the same thing, really. Acting, directing, painting, it's all writing, it's all art. It just depends how you get the story out, but it's, to me, it's all the same thing. This is full circle for me, just as a quick sidebar. My first job in movies was an usher at the Melbourne Film Festival in 1967, at the Palais. I was an usher. And I was a terrible usher because I was just looking at the movies and people would say, where do I sit? I said, oh, thank you, sir. I remember Joseph von Sternberg had a retrospective and he opened an exhibition of paintings of Mirka at Tolano. And Mirka said to him, you must see my son's film. I made a film called Man in a Film, an 8mm film, where I was inspired by Fellini. I whipped my girlfriend on the beach at Aspendale on a cross. And so Mirka convinced Sternberg. So I'm sitting in my room at Tolano with Joseph von Sternberg, lacing up my animal projector. And the film's like 10 minutes or something. And the film finishes and he says, are these your paintings? And I said, yes, sir. They're my paintings, and he said, stick to film.
So I did.
Can I ask you both a question? What characteristics of each of your parents do you think have kind of infiltrated your outlook and personality and, attitude to life?
I don't think that's a sort of what one does that consciously. I mean, I'm told I'm a lot like my father and that Philippe's a lot like Mirka and the left side, right side of the brain. Philippe's very creative, like as is Mirka. He likes to be in the spotlight. Mm-hmm. I like to be out of the spotlight. who knows what the influence that your parents has on you. Obviously, it's huge. And I think we've each taken the characteristics we've had, but I feel I'm a lot more like my father. I've followed more in his footsteps of promoting art rather than creating art.
But you were the star of my first film.
Yeah, I was the cross.
Willie was a child actor in my film called Dreams in a Grey Afternoon with John and Sunday Reid, 8mm film. But Willie, unfortunately, I would ask him to do stunts, which is a bit dangerous to an 8-year-old. But and I remember we used to go to Fitzroy Gardens, and we used to catch yabbies in the pond in Fitzroy Gardens. And
illegal to buy firecrackers in those days too.
We would be trying to throw firecrackers at possums and ogre for the movie, of course. But I remember I asked you to jump in the pond, which you did like a true actor.
Just to follow that up some more, you've both got heavily involved in the arts. It's like breathing it in with your mother's milk, so to speak.
I wouldn't compare those two.
Sucking it up.
I know what you mean.
Yeah.
You're going to call me an ass.
But you haven't gone out on a tangent and said, well, I'm going to go and do science. Or...
I studied accounting for 2 years before I went back to the fold. Yeah. It was our whole life. We grew up in restaurants and galleries, and one of the things Philippe and I used to love to do was after Mercury and George had one of their all-night parties, and finally everyone had gone home at 8 a.m. in the morning, Philippe and I would go to all the surfers and run our hands down the back, because there'd always be all this change that had fallen out of people's...
A lot of money. We loved the party.
It was a £5 party. And that was
also, we had a lot of artists and actors and dancers and artists visiting our place all the time, including Marcel Marceau. From an early age, Marceau would visit us at Aspendale. We thought he was a freak because... He would get he'd wait till everyone finished eating, and then he would pour the olive oil from the salad bowl all over his body at Aspendale or something, rub it in, and say, this olive oil is really good for your skin. Well, as kids, we thought, disgusting. But we'd wait, it was very entertaining. But over the years, I guess my point is, we met a lot of artists of all kinds, so that definitely printed on us. Because our parents always treated artists with great respect and fed them when they needed food.
Apart from the art side, this is my final question. I'm interested in the sort of politics as well, like George being a former member of the Communist Party. Did that kind of influence him in later life as well, or was that just something that was particular to Germany, or did it have...
I'll have a crack at answering that one, because I'm very interested in it myself. Mm-hmm. I know that ASIO had a file on him when he arrived, because they knew that he was a member of the Communist Party. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, the Nazis had been after him, so that was points for him. but the thing is, he was very much a man of the left, and he had a lot of great friends in the Labour Party, but he was the kind of guy that also... He's a very sophisticated guy. He also had friends who were very conservative. He really crossed the lines. He was just a civilized kind of a guy. And we were brought up, I think, we definitely were brought up in a kind of a left-wing environment. I remember, I don't remember actually, but I know from documents that he early on wrote to Menzies and to the Minister of the Arts in the early 50s, saying that Australian art should be shown overseas, because the Menzies government was showing very conservative, boring art by artists we hadn't even heard of anymore. And my father knew all these young artists, Black, Percival, everyone, that the Nolan paintings were there, which they would exhibit in our home. And my father was saying, this art should be shown overseas. So from early on, he was an activist for Australian art, which is, I think, fantastic.
He was also very active, as Philippe says, as a letter to the editor-writer. He used to write virtually one a week and on all kinds of issues, but always with a very strong sort of left slant. And We were certainly brought up with a very left. I mean, it was that interesting aspect that we mixed with the right, or the conservative, wealthy people, who were all tended to be very to the right, whereas George was very to the left. I remember one dinner party that George Mercer were invited to with Harold Holt when he was Prime Minister, and the host was a very well-known Melbourne stockbroker, and he introduced George to, it was a small dinner party of about 10 people, but here's my left-wing friend, and he was a sort of token lefty at this very conservative dinner party, and would love to talk politics in it, and God forbid if any of us ever didn't vote for Labour, you know, George would roll over in his grave.
Yeah, you know, I remember at Delano in the late years, I remember, well, the restaurants were always the best restaurants in town. So the whole establishment, whatever it was, would be there. But I remember one night, Sir Charles Spry, who was head of ASIO, came to Delano in the early years. And Merca was always very entertaining. And she said to Charles Spry, "Oh, Philippe, go and get your drawings about Vietnam." And I'd done all these drawings about soldiers being dismembered and little babies being napalmed and all this. They were just hot. George Gross, I love George Gross, I still do. And so she says, show us Charles. And so I'm showing Sir Charles Spry's, and I can see his eyes getting wider and wider as the babies are being napalmed. It's the middle of the Vietnam War, and he finally says, "Merkel, why do you think your son is so cruel?" And she said, "No, he's not cruel. He's not cruel. He's just influenced by George Gross." So anyway, that was kind of thing that was going on all the time.
I mean, being involved in the arts gives you that opportunity to mix with an amazing, diverse range of people, and I think George and Merkel both revelled in that. And then also having restaurants meant that when people were socialising, you know, that's when you were there at that time with them. So it afforded this, you know, we grew up in restaurants and we were often be under the tables at the end of service watching everybody have their sort of fabulous parties after service had finished and so on. But you know, it was a way, or it was a time then when everyone was discovering new ideas, especially left-wing ideas, left-wing literature, French literature, poetry, and so on. And George and Mirka, by having restaurants, became a kind of centre for people to gather and discuss all these ideas. And of course, supporting artists. George's only rule when we lived at the Tolano was that we had to be there for dinner, otherwise we could basically come and go as we pleased. And dinner was at 7 p.m. and every night there were at least one or two artists who would join us for dinner.
In retrospect, we really had quite a privileged childhood meeting all these people. I remember when On the Beach was being filmed in Melbourne. I'm not sure when that would have been, 59 or something, I'm not sure exactly. But the cast, Ava Gardner, Fred Astaire, Anthony Perkins, all these people would eat at Delano all the time. Well, I'd come home from school and have dinner with Ava Gardner. And I can see it, and I can see her face now. She was incredibly beautiful. I was just like transfixed, even, I don't know, when I was 12 or something. So we had a rare childhood, but it was the mixture of the high and the low, and the snobs and the working class, and the below, you know, the criminals and prime ministers, and it was such a cross section, and there you go.
Is there any more questions, or is that our time up? Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.